Now, after many years of practicing, performing, and teaching dance, I can formulate my philosophies. I believe that to dance is a way to the soul, to the very center of our being. I believe that when we dance, we can experience the life force that is in us all, and thereby feel the connectedness to all living things. I know that dance is communication and a way of sharing our innermost feelings and aspirations on a very deep level. Dance is a transitory, non-verbal, non-tangible art form. And when we perform dance with honesty, integrity, and great aesthetic quality, it can reach people's hearts and change the shape and pathways of their lives. The whole contemporary art movement of this century. We used music, for example, in quite a different way from the classical ballet choreographers. We were influenced by mood, texture, weight, phrasing, complex rhythms and percussions, electronic and concrete music. When I was choreographing Homage to Botticelli, for example, I found a beautiful soundscape of Luciano Berio, who used Kathy Barbarian chanting half words and broken sounds.
A veil of wave, also fluted, the spikes winding cold, silent wrists.
It was a challenge for me because I was forced to discover new movements that suited this particular score. We introduced new sound to dance theatre in Australia, thereby also educating our audiences in contemporary music. Amongst the composers I used for my choreographies were prime movers of the contemporary music scene. They included people such as Henk Bardings, Peter Sculthorpe, Ravi Shankar, Richard Mille, Lasri Bachet, Franz Rabat, John Coltrane, Clifford Brown, Ian Cugley, George Dreyfus and Nicholas Lyon. We dared to dance in silence, or even to bird sounds, so pioneering an avant-garde approach to dance theatre. This opened up to us a diverse collaboration with artists from other disciplines. Indeed, we felt connected to painters, sculptors, musicians, architects, photographers, and craftspeople in the way we worked and in how we viewed the world. This was our home for many years. Such a beautiful studio, spacious, light and airy, with a panoramic, wide-sweeping view to the Adelaide Hills, which kept us daily connected to the bush. It had a good wooden floor, crucial for our dancing in bare feet. It was important for us to experience the freedom of such dancing, to feel the connection to the earth, to use weight and gravity in the way we moved, and through our sensory awareness and sensory experiences, to express better what we wanted to say. In bare feet, we could do this more easily. This is where I established my school of dance. I taught modern dance techniques and gave classes in jazz and Black American dance. I led workshops in improvisation and composition, gradually developing my own style. It attracted mainly university students and young people from the workforce. As these students showed promise and commitment, they were streamed into company classes, some later being invited to become company members. Initially, dancers came from Leslie White's classical ballet studio. Leslie and I had collaborated since 1964. Indeed, he, alongside my husband John Dowman and Kevin Roberts, was a part of the founding of Australian Dance Theatre. However, after 18 months with the company, Leslie's long, distinguished career in classical ballet took him interstate. I then took the helm of the company, establishing it as a full-time modern dance company. I looked for dancers with talent, who were committed and hard-working, with individuality and an intelligent mind. I set out to build a company on honesty and with integrity so that the artist within each dancer could grow and develop. I believed that the quality of our performances was a reflection of the spirit within the company and had significant influence on the way we communicated with our audiences. Therefore, it was important for us to have respect and understanding for each other and to work for the harmony within the group. We were more than just a dance company, for we lived like a family, sharing so much of ourselves. The dancers not only danced, but also designed, made costumes, did the PR and the administration, cleaned the studio and taught in the school. Even when I went to New York in 1966 for further training and on an overseas tour in 1968, with Jon taking Jennifer Barry and Sarah Dunstan with me, several of the dancers, Gillian Millard, Carolyn Bishop, Bobby Kandel, and Sally Tugwell, took on the responsibility of the school, continuing with the classes, performances, and educational programs. The Workshop Theatre in Gay's Arcade, Adelaide, set up in 1967 on my return from intensive studies in New York at the end of 1966, was an excellent venue for our educational activities. We also ran lunchtime performances, particularly at Christmas time or during the festivals, and our Sunday night workshop performances became a well-known happening in Adelaide at the time. These performances continued for 7 to 8 years, adding to our attendance figures, which often reached 17,000 in 1 year. From this studio, we created and rehearsed our repertoire, never stopping until the work was to our satisfaction. We prepared for our tours interstate and overseas. We hosted visiting dancers, choreographers and companies. We held summer and winter schools and many creative dance and compositional workshops for teachers. Modern dance is not just technique, and there are many individual techniques. It is also philosophy. A dancer who discovers modern dance usually embarks upon a journey of self-discovery, for it demands that we question ourselves on many levels and that we are honest in our answers. Many times it becomes a journey of awakening, of change, of transformation, and of personal growth. We're required to question our motives for our actions, to be observant of the way we move in our everyday life, of our relationship to the world in which we live, and our responses to events that happen around us. And so we do not escape the world in the dance studio in an effort to practice and perfect a traditional technique, but we bring the world into the studio and create a technique from the world as we feel it and know it. As subject material for our dance works, we questioned what was happening in Australia and in the rest of the world at the time. Issues we felt strongly about we expressed in dance. Issues such as freedom, peace, in Vietnam in particular, social injustice and women's rights. I explored the sources of movement from within the body and the different dynamics of movement as they travel from the source inside to the space outside. I search for purity of line, for focus and economy of movement. I train dancers in awareness of the body in space and in performance techniques. I valued the importance of image in movement and of the dancer bringing his or her own life experience to the dance. The improvisational sessions, confronting as they were, opened us all up to our own inner truths. By allowing ourselves to be vulnerable, to put ourselves on the line, we were able to confront our fears and habitual movement patterns, let go of our inhibitions, and so explore new ways to express honestly what we really wanted to say. This philosophy and way of teaching dance was often interpreted as rebellious. Indeed, I have for years been known as the rebel of the dance in Australia. However, I was only searching my truth and encouraging the dancers in the company to search theirs. They responded well and were as excited as I was in their discoveries, and so we fired each other on. We had a close affinity with and were inspired by the folk singers of the time, such as Peter, Paul and Mary, who were writing and singing ballads about world issues. After their first Australian tour, a close friendship was formed, uniting the dance and the song, which pioneered interpretive dance.
Be over. I had a little book was given to me, and every page spelled liberty.
This train, a suite of seven songs